I wonder if you would turn to Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 1, that reading that we had this evening. Now, this is a wonderful letter. It's a letter which shows us not so much Paul, the theologian of Christ, although there is strong theology found in the letter, but really what we have here more is Paul's personal experience of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Saviour that he knew and he loved. And in this letter, if you like, here is life in Christ lived out. It shows the Christian's source and secret, the secret for the Christian of true peace and contentment. And it reveals to us in the closest detail the man who learned the secret of true peace and contentment. But really it shows us the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the secret and the source of true peace and contentment. Now in his opening to the letter, Paul speaks to the Philippians that they are the saints of God, the hagios, the called out ones. They've been called out of the world into the fellowship of the Lord Jesus Christ, and they've been called into fellowship with one another. And having come to know God's grace and God's peace, Paul's desire is that they would increasingly know God's grace and God's peace. But what is Paul's regard of these Philippian Christians? How does he think of them? Well, they're a great source of joy unto Paul. Every time he thinks of them, his heart is lifted and his day, as it were, brightens as he thinks of these Christians there at Philippi. And Paul, really, in these opening verses, he gives a wonderful example to the Philippian Christians, but also he gives a wonderful example to us. We're going to look especially at verses 3 through to 6. Paul says, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you all, making request with joy for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. So our title tonight is this: The Thankful Christian. The Thankful Christian. We've got 2 points. We're going to see, firstly, Paul is thankful. And secondly, we're going to think, why is he thankful? Paul is thankful. But secondly, why is he thankful? Well, firstly, Paul is thankful. Now, what we have to say is one of the marks of our society today. Various things we could say, couldn't we? Increasing liberalism, acceptance of that which is contrary to God's law, but also it seems, I think, very much that there's increasing unthankfulness, really, in our society. So many good things that people enjoy, that they have, and yet it seems that no one is very satisfied with what they have. And it's quite interesting that you can go out to other countries and you can find people there who have very little by way of goods and services in this life. And yet they're much more content with what they have. We don't really live in an age of thankfulness, but really an age of selfishness so much in our society. It seems the more people have, the less contented they are. And so sometimes this can rub off on us as Christians. We can start to find that we start to sort of have a mindset of the world around us. We can start to be those who enjoy a good moan. And perhaps we can find that we're often complaining. The grumpy old man, the grumpy old woman. My wife says I'm a bit grumpy on a Monday. I'm often very tired on a Monday. And anyway, but is grumpiness something which should mark us out as the people of God? I don't believe it is. Look at the Apostle Paul here in this letter. This man is being held in Rome. He's either in prison or he's under house arrest. and is bound by uncomfortable chains, which must have rubbed against his wrists, perhaps even his ankles, and impeded his movements. From what we know, at times he felt very cold. He requests a cloak at one particular time. He's being run down, he's being condemned, even by other Christians there in Rome. He's being kept back from being able to go out and visit his beloved churches. But as far as we know, he will soon be taken. As far as he can tell, he'll soon be taken by a group of thuggish Roman soldiers who will take him out and they'll chop his head off. Well, Paul, what will you say to all this? What will you say to this dire situation that you're in? Will you give us a list of moans and groans and bitterness? And what does Paul say at the beginning of verse 3? He says, I thank God. I thank God. This man has a grateful and a thankful heart. See, this is what the Lord Jesus has done for the Apostle Paul. It's made him into a thankful and a joyful man, despite his circumstances. Of course, what we're saying today is that we're not expected to become blind optimists, those who've lost touch with reality. We're always going to call black white and white black. Nor are we those who expect to just put a brave face on everything. Some people, you know, you can ask, how are you? And they feel, well, they've always got a smile and saying, I'm okay, yeah, I'm okay. They feel they're letting the side down, they're being unchristian if they're admitted being discouraged or upset or distressed. Now you see, the Bible says we're to bear one another's burdens. How can we do that? We never know what one another's burdens are. Sometimes we've got to share our burdens with each other. Lord, we fail to acknowledge, as the psalmist often did, that there are things which can cause us distress, and cause us grief, and cause us to mourn. We're not expected just to go around with sort of like a plastic smile on our faces. How is it that Paul could preserve this sense of thankfulness, even amidst such difficult and threatening circumstances? Well, Paul's secret, in part, was in those verses, with that, those words we have there in verse 3. Because notice, if you look again, he doesn't say, I thank God. But he says, I thank my God. I thank my God. Paul has found this undefeatable joy in one he can call my God. Here is this aged man living in this confinement, cut off from his beloved churches, fellow believers, thwarted in fulfilling his ministry, feeling the cold and facing death. He's really, in many ways, he's a tiny speck in this vast universe. And yet he can look up to the infinite one, the one who is God, and he can call him my God. He's my God. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. One of the wonderful promises that God has given me. This is the reason, you see, for Paul's bias towards thankfulness. He's been brought into this closest relationship, the closest of relationships, the most wonderful of relationships with the one who is his maker, the one who is God. Is that your experience tonight? This is the wonder of the gospel. This is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. It's a wonderful experience for the one who truly comes to know the Lord Jesus Christ. They come to know this glorious God. They're reconciled to him. They're brought into relationship with him. They have this real experience of knowing God and of knowing his love. Isn't that a cause for thankfulness? Isn't that a source of thankfulness? To think that God, because of his mercy towards me in the Lord Jesus Christ, I belong to him. He belongs to me. I am and will ever be his. and he will be mine. So you see, whatever I go through, God is my God. And what's more, he's promised to be mine and to be with me right to the end, all my days. Psalm 48, verse 14, that this is God, our God, forever and ever. He will be our guide, even to death. Now this church that Paul had founded, which was a joy to him, wasn't in fact a perfect church. There were things that Paul has to mention to them. They had to do things without complaining and without arguing, without doing it through selfish ambition or deceit. And Paul has to speak to two of the members in that church who weren't getting on. And yet, though there were these difficulties, Paul could see the triumph of grace in the lives of these believers, and he acknowledged what was good. And so he gave great thanks to God for them. He says there, doesn't he? I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always every prayer of mine, for you all, making requests with joy. There were things that they needed to put right, yet he could see that there was this desire to ultimately glorify God and walk with God. And he gave thanks to God for them. But you know, there were particular things that Paul makes mention of here in these verses which caused him to rejoice. Particular things he could see in that church. So Paul is a thankful Christian. He's thankful because he can see the work of grace that's going on in the hearts and lives of those Philippian believers. He's also thankful because he knows the one who is his God, his glorious God. And yet, Paul is thankful as well for other things. So, having seen Paul as a thankful Christian, secondly, why is he thankful? Why is he thankful? Well, three reasons. Three reasons why Paul is thankful. And the first is this. He says in verse 6, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you. He which hath begun a good work in you. Paul rejoices because God had begun a good work in those Philippian Christians. There were two very well-known members of that Philippian church. I don't know if you know who I'm speaking of. Actually, there were three well-known members, but I believe there's a third, but there were two particularly well-known ones, Lydia and the Philippian jailer. Who saved Lydia? Who saved the Philippian jailer? Was it that there was some small hidden part of Lydia, in Lydia and in the jailer, that from the time they were born, had this inherent desire to respond to the message of the gospel, and therefore by their own strength and their own will to come to Christ? Well, if that was so, we would have to say it wasn't God who began a good work in Lydia and in the Philippian jailer. It was they who had the capacity and the ability to start that good work. But you know, that is never the case. It's never the case. The Bible says that when we're unsaved and unbelieving, it's not that we're sort of a little alive spiritually, or that we have a spark of life or an ember of life. No, the Bible says we're dead in trespasses and sins. We're like Lazarus in the tomb. He was dead. He could not raise himself. He could not make himself alive. So too were we, you see, once when we were outside of Christ. We had no desire for the things of God. We saw the things of God as foolish, really. We may have given them some attention, but really, they had no appeal to us. We were those who preferred darkness rather than light. We preferred to be away from God, to be going away from God than going towards God, really. But wonderfully, Paul says to the Ephesians, and you he made alive. You he made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins. It was God, God alone, who had begun that good work in them. It is God, you see, who must intervene. It is God who must begin a good work. Who is it who opened Lydia's heart? Lydia? No. The word says, the Lord opened her heart to heed the things spoken by Paul. The Lord opened her heart. This is how God works when he saves. There was once a man who went to hear George Whitfield preach. He was preaching in the open air. And he was carrying several stones to throw at George Whitfield's head. But as the sermon began, and the man stood there, gradually the stones were dropped, one by one. He let the stones go. And so instead of the man breaking Whitfield's head, instead of the man breaking Whitfield's head, God broke the man's heart. God broke his fat man's heart and began a good work. From the hearing of the man once who sat under the ministry for 30 years. And one day he went to the preacher and said, "Why didn't you tell me these things before?" And yet it was the same message he heard that day that he'd heard for those 30 years. But you see, God, on that day, God had broken into his heart. God had begun a good work in him. Are we thankful today? We know that if God hadn't worked in us, if God hadn't chosen to work in our hearts, we know that we would never of ourselves desire him. We bless him, don't we? We bless him, we marvel. Something we can never give thanks for, no matter how hard things are, no matter how difficult things might be. God is nothing. God has worked in my heart. God has drawn me to himself. God has begun his good work in me. But what had this regenerating work that God had done in the hearts of these Philippian believers, what did it produce? What was the fruit of that work? Well, we see Paul is also thankful because the gospel, secondly, the gospel was still their priority. The gospel was still their priority. He says, "I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you all, making request with joy for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now." These Philippians still have this strong fellowship in the gospel with Paul. Now the word fellowship there can mean partnership. They have this partnership with Paul in the gospel. He thanked God that their partnership, which began on the day they were converted and submitted to the Lord Jesus Christ, was still as strong and as committed now as it was then. Paul rejoiced that these believers were still partners with him. They still loved the same gospel. They still upheld and sought to proclaim the same gospel that they had believed when they were converted through the preaching of the Apostle Paul. I wonder, what could be the most precious association or partnership that we could be involved with? There are some who make a big point of being involved in certain associations, certain partnerships. Some feel it would be a great privilege to be a member of the Lawn Tennis Association of Wimbledon this time of year. You go and enjoy the privileges that people enjoy at Wimbledon. Or perhaps there are some who think, well, to be an honorary member of Oxford or Cambridge University, what a privilege that would be. To be invited to the fellowship of the Royal Institution, or to be a member of the Royal College of Surgeons. Some think that would be a great privilege. Others might feel, well, to be a member of the Privy Council, to be amongst the inner select, close confidants who give advice to the Queen. What a privilege that would be, to be one who is involved in such a particular association. So really no association or partnership in this world compare to the fellowship that the Christian knows and the Christian is involved in. A partner in the everlasting gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. One who belongs to the affiliation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You see, this was a sign of God's blessing upon this church there in Philippi. Sign of God's presence and blessing with this church is that you continue in the partnership of the gospel. You continue in the fellowship in the gospel with the Lord Jesus Christ. They kept praying for conversions. They kept seeking to do all that they could to further the gospel, to make the gospel known through the preaching and through the testimony and the life of the church. They hadn't sort of become distracted. They hadn't become detached from the work of the gospel. Many people can do that today. Many who profess to be Christians. The gospel almost becomes like a sort of sideline. We give attention to it at certain times, perhaps on a Sunday, that sort of thing, but the rest of the week it's still in their thoughts, still in their minds. They've got no real burden for the work of the gospel, for the gospel to go forward. And yet it's wonderful that these believers still continued firmly in that fellowship, that partnership that they had with Paul from the beginning. They weren't distracted. They weren't looking elsewhere. They were continuing to proclaim the gospel and to make it known and to see it as the most precious thing they could declare unto those people who were around them. So it's wonderful when you have believers who, even to their dying day, they see their fellowship in the gospel with the Lord Jesus Christ and with other believers. They see it as the most precious thing. You go and visit some elderly saints, perhaps their house bound now, they can't get out, and yet, you know, they'll say to you, how has it worked out? How is so-and-so? How is so-and-so doing? They've got a concern for the work. Their greatest joy is still in the gospel. They're always praying for the gospel. They're always praying for the work of God. Lovely to see this church, as I say, still committed and faithful to the gospel, seeking and longing to share it with those round about. We pray that should the Lord tarry, the church will still continue faithfully in the gospel, in the partnership and fellowship of the gospel, seeking again to make it known as it can to those in the area. Are you in the fellowship of the gospel? Are you one who is in the partnership of the gospel? You're doing all you can, you're contributing in some way, even if it's just by way of prayer. You're contributing in some way to furthering the kingdom of Christ. There are some who claim to be Christians, and yet sadly you find some Christians today, they're nomads. They wander around from church to church. They go here, they go there, but they don't want any real commitment to the things of God and to the work and life of the church. They don't realize how the local church is precious to God, is a glory to God, that there God dwells, there God reveals his glory all the more. And yet they just drift. They don't settle, they don't put roots down anywhere, they don't seek to become partners in the fellowship of the gospel. You get some who very much want a bespoke Christianity. A certain sort of secondary issues that they sort of feel are important. They want every box ticked. And they don't see that the primary things that should unite us is the gospel of Jesus Christ, faithfulness to the word, faithfulness in the worship of God, faithfulness in evangelism, in seeking to proclaim the gospel. And they just drift, they wander around. Paul here was thankful for his people. Not only had God begun a good work in them, but it was evident that work was ongoing because they were still faithful to the gospel, still faithful in the partnership of the gospel, still labouring there in Philippi to the glory of God. of the extension of the kingdom of Christ. But there's a third reason why Paul is thankful. He gives thanks because God has begun a good work in him. He gives thanks because they are still those who see the gospel as their priority, and they're still partners in the gospel that Paul had committed to them. But thirdly, Paul is thankful because the work God had begun, he would complete. The work God had begun, he would complete. I thank my God for every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you all, making requests with joy for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. And there are some who have a very long waiting list. Some workmen who have very long waiting lists. They can be very hard to get hold of. We've sought at times to employ builders or plasterers, sometimes painters. And people want them, they're in demand. Why is that? It'd be hard to get them to come and do the job you want them to do, and yet eventually you're glad you can find a slot and they can come and do the work. People won't have anyone else. They're prepared to wait for them to come. Why is that? Well, you see, perhaps a certain skill is needed, but also the people know that when this man starts a job, he will finish it. He will make it good. There won't be any half measures. In many ways, his reputation is on the line when he starts that job. And you know, it's the same with God. The same with God. The one who starts a good work must and will complete it. He who hath begun a good work in you will perform it. The Greek there is to bring it to completion. He will finish it until the day of Jesus Christ. Did God begin that work in you? He won't do a half job. He won't leave it unfinished. How terrible it would be, wouldn't it, if God ever were to start the work and then to leave it so it wasn't completed. How disorganized it would seem God is. How utterly inglorious it would be to God if he were ever to start a work and then not finish it. But no, we think how this almighty, this all-wise, this sovereign God, he set up the whole machinery of redemption, as it were. He set up the whole plan of redemption. And if it's God who set it up, it's not going to fall apart. And it's not going to fail. You know what the Apostle Paul teaches here, he teaches elsewhere. The Word of God teaches elsewhere. We find it throughout the pages of Scripture. In John chapter 6 and verse 39. Christ says, and this is the Father's will which has sent me, that all of which he hath given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again at the last day. John 10, verse 27. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. By well-known words in Romans 8, verse 38. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. 2 Timothy, and chapter 4 and verse 18. Again, the Apostle Paul speaks here of his own testimony and his own confidence. He says, and the Lord shall deliver me from every evil work and will preserve me unto his heavenly kingdom, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Believer, if God has begun a good work in you, if you are his, despite the malice of this world and the devil, the ridicule and hostility of unbelievers, the threats of persecution, the pain of trials, poor health, even death, if you do not make it safe into heaven, then God can no longer be called God. He who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. You might say, what are those who say they're Christians and yet fall away? Alas, sadly, we have to say there are some we've known, and for a time we've known them as brothers in Christ, and yet to our sorrow, today they are found far from God and far from the Lord Jesus Christ. What do we say about those? Well, we have to say that those who fall away never really knew him. That good work was never truly begun in them if they fall away completely. Does this wonderful promise that God gives us, he who has begun a good work in you will complete it unto the day of Jesus Christ, will perform it? Does it mean I can then sin without worry? No, it doesn't. When God begins a new work, when he begins a work in us, the first thing he does is give us a new nature, which means we cannot live as we once did. We cannot sin with impurity. We're a true child of God, will know sorrow, will know grief, God's chastening, repentance, and restoration if we're a true child of God. John Newton, in the book Grace Abounding to the Chief of Sinners, he talks about how he was wrestling with the thought of the power of the devil and the power of God. And he speaks about a dream that he had at this time. We'll be very careful in dreams. Sometimes they can be used, yes, of God to speak to us, but sometimes, of course, they're not. They're just things of our imagination. And yet this particular dream, Newton found very helpful as he was grappling with these things. And he speaks of it, as I say, in his biography. And the dream was that there he was on a ship. You know that he was a man who often sailed ships. And he was in Naples Harbour. And this most glorious man appeared to him. And the man gave him this most precious ring. And he said, take care of that ring. Look after that ring. And this glorious man disappeared off the scene. And then a more hideous, a more dark and threatening man appeared. And he mocked him. He mocked our Newton. And he said, oh, that ring is no good. That ring is worthless. That ring is of no help to you at all. Why are you seeking to look after that ring? Eventually, he was persuaded by the man to throw the ring overboard if it was worthless. A glorious man reappeared and came to Newton again. He said, where is the ring? And Newton confessed to his shame that he'd given way to the insinuations of this other, more sinister man and thrown the ring overboard. A glorious man dived over the side of the ship, went down into the depths, found the ring, brought it back up. As he stood by Newton once more, Newton held out his hand to receive the ring, and the man refused to give it back. No, he said, no. The ring is yours, it will ever be yours, but I will keep it for you. I will keep it for you. That's it, you see. What is the true child of God? Is the one who, Peter tells us, is kept by the power of God. The true Lord's salvation is ours and will ever be ours. And yet it's the Lord who will keep us. He who has begun a good work in us will perform it, will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. What a thing that is. Friend, do you know this Saviour? Do you know the Lord Jesus Christ? If you do, rejoice. Rejoice. Whatever lies ahead, he who has begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. He will complete it. Don't despair. We don't know what we face, do we? Some of us more younger ones, as it were. We don't know what we might face, whether it's dementia, whether it's cancer, whether it's the loss of our faculties, we don't despair, because there is one who is keeping us. There is one who has promised never to leave us nor forsake us. There's one who has promised that nothing can snatch us from his hand, that he who hath begun a good work in us will perform it, will complete it, until the day of Jesus Christ. How unknown many of these people were here in Philippi. Many of them were slaves. How little thought of they were in there in that mini row. Yet Paul, oh, he gave thanks for them. He rejoiced in them. He loved them. They were those who God had begun good work in. They were those who were partners in the wonderful fellowship of the gospel. And they were continuing as partners in the gospel. And they were those who God would complete his work in. Are you a joyful Christian? Or are we those who have lost sight of all that is ours in Christ? We can do that, can't we? We can lose sight of it. And yet all that is ours in the Lord, all that he's promised to do, may we be those who thank God for his great grace towards us, thank God for all that he's done for us, all that he promises to do to us. May we look to God to be with us for another year in the life of this church in Tower. May we realise that he is doing that work in us. He will keep us. He will preserve us as we look to him. May we encourage one another in these things and rejoice in them for ourselves. Who is this God? Who is he? That he should make such promises to us, that he should give us such certainties in this world of uncertainty, seeming uncertainty, where everything is changing. How wonderful. God is ever the same. God is God. And he is the one who will complete that work in us. He's the one who will keep his promises. May we bless him. May we praise him. May we walk before him with confidence and with joy. For his name's sake. Amen. Amen.